Hello everyone to this special Thursday live stream. I forgot to tell you guys about this, which is quite bad, but still, I'll be away this Saturday, so I won't be able to do a stream on Saturday as usual. So I decided to make one today, and I will upload it as to YouTube as always, so we don't get behind. So each week there is a new video, and for those who won't be able to make it today on Thursday, the stream will be available on YouTube on Saturday, so you can watch it as usual at the same time. And yeah, today I want to dive into some real cool gameplay so that we can start playing with the game a little bit. By now, up until now, we've been developing features just to get up and running, and let's check out a little bit what we did so far. So we can walk around, we can grab our sword. Let me make this bigger. And last week we implemented these rupees, and up here there's a counter, so we can collect those. We have enemies that we can attack now, so they can attack us and they will push us back, but we can attack them back and destroy them, and they have this nice animation when they get destroyed, which is pretty cool. And last week we also created some random drops when we destroy these bushes here, so sometimes at random there will be some... I'm pretty unlucky. There you go. So sometimes at random there's a drop here. And yeah, that's what we did last week, and I decided for this week that I want to... Well, first of all, I want to start up by implementing gamepad controls, and this should be very simple, and it's a nice warm-up, and we created the code in such a way that it's really easy to change the keyboard control to gamepad control, or actually I want to just have them both active at the same time. And that's really simple, so it's a good start. And then I want to get into some random level generation, because I thought about what I can do with this game, because it's starting to look like a real game, and I want it to be a real game as well. It's not supposed to be just a tutorial. I mean, it's supposed to be a tutorial series, but I also want to basically finish this game so it will have all the things that a proper game needs to have, like menus and stuff like that. And then I want to push it to Steam and on tablets, on mobile devices, and maybe even consoles. We'll see. We'll see where we can push it. And pushing the game to all this devices will be part of the tutorial series. So you'll see the process on how to push a game to Steam or to iOS and Android. And yeah. And then lastly, I want to change the camera that we have a little bit. Right now the camera basically just follows us, and we are in the center at all times. But in Zelda the camera behaves a little bit differently. So there are these camera zones that the camera just cannot get over. So for example, if let's assume a camera zone would be here, we would go to the edge of the camera zone, and then the character would continue walking, but the camera would be stuck. So we can walk towards the edge of the screen. And then there are some entrances, like this for example, and then when we pass the entrance, the camera would pan down quickly to the next section, and then we can walk around in that section. And for the random level generation that I have in mind, this is actually a really cool way to do this, because then each scene is basically a room, and we can switch rooms, and it's easy to make some random level generation by just placing multiple rooms next to each other and stuff like that. So that should work pretty well for this game. All right, so well, let me first of all grab my gamepad controller so we can start working on that. So for now the controls are really simple, but one thing that a gamepad controller has different has instead of a keyboard is that it can go in any direction. And the keyboard can basically just go into a direction, and I kind of want to, I think I want to limit the movement to a direction, so the gamepad will have the same feel, because that's how Zelda worked, and I want to reach that feel of Zelda. So we're going to limit the direction to 8, even though we have the full range of motion on the gamepad here. And then we have two actions. We have the attack action, and then we have the use whatever item, whatever object is nearby action. So it's basically controls are like the sticks, the analog stick or the D-pad for movement, and then A for attack, and I think X for using objects. We'll see about that, what the buttons are. But this is really simple, and I'm still not going to use. Well, I'm going to use the Unity Input Manager a little bit, but well, actually, why not? Let's use the Unity Input Manager for that. So first of all, we need to create a script that handles our gamepad input, and I'm going to just duplicate the keyboard controller, and then we change the script so it works. So we have the character keyboard control. Let's duplicate that and call this character gamepad control. Let's make sure that we rename this in our script as well. Character gamepad control, and then we just add both both components to our character, so we can use the keyboard and the gamepad at the same time. So we have our keyboard control here. Let's add a new component to our character gamepad control, and I just move this up quickly so it's next to the keyboard control. Okay, let's see what we did here in the keyboard control. So this is the renamed gamepad control now, but all this code is still keyboard code. We don't need that because the start method is still being called on the keyboard control. So basically what we can start doing is just replace these, because using a gamepad is actually similar to using the keys. Because we're using the input class here, Unity also has a key code for gamepad stuff. So, no, it's called joystick. So we have joystick 1, button 0, and this goes up to joystick 8. And then below that we also have joystick button 0. So we can talk to the specific gamepads or joysticks, joystick 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 through 8. Or we can just listen to all of them, and so we can just use the joystick button 0, and then whatever gamepad you have, and however many gamepads you have available, every gamepad that presses the A button will trigger this. So joystick button 0 is the A button, and as far as I remember, I forgot to open up a keyboard mapping for Unity, but I think joystick button 0 is the A button and 1 is the B button. So let's see if that works. So we have on attack pressed here and on action pressed for the button 1. And we still don't have movement, so we just have keyboard movement for now. But so let's get the sword with the keyboard and then press A on the gamepad. That works. And let's go to the sign here, and with B we can read it. I think that's fine for now. So A for attack, B for interacting with objects and stuff like that. So the buttons are done, and now we need the movement. And to do that, we're going to use the Unity Input Manager. So we go to Edit, I think it's off screen here, but I go to Edit, Project Settings and Input. And then we have the input manager open here in our inspector. So let's open the axes. And there are a couple of axes that are already set. So we have a horizontal and vertical axis, and that is set up to left, right, A, and D. and the vertical axis is to the arrow keys and W and S. So you have WASD and arrow key movement for those. And then you have a couple buttons, and then you have horizontal and vertical set up again, but this time it's set up for, so in the beginning, the top one here, it's set up for a key or a mouse button. It's set to type key or mouse button. And down here, horizontal is set to joystick axis. And you can have as many axes with the same name as you want, and they just going to work in tandem. So since we already implemented the buttons, so we could implement the buttons here as well, but well, let's do that just to demonstrate how this whole thing works. So we're not going to use the mouse. We can delete that with, and then the keys here, the fire, 1, 2, 3 and jump buttons, we don't need those, so let's remove those. And then the horizontal and vertical for keyboard input, we remove those as well. So we only want to have the joystick stuff, and let's remove all the other. We need two buttons, and we remove all the other buttons, and we rename those buttons as attack and interact. And the benefit of this is that you're not accessing buttons directly like we did before here, but you're accessing, you can access the input stuff by name. And they're being set up the same thing. So you see here the attack name, the attack axis basically, is being triggered by the positive button joystick button 0, which is the same button that we used here, joystick button 0. But you can address it by using the attack name, which is cool, because then when you build the game, you can give the user an options menu that says, so they can remap their controls. So they know, well, the attack key is used by joystick button 0. I wanted to have a joystick button 2, for example, so they can remap it. And since you're getting the input via this name and not with the direct key here, the remapping works seamlessly, basically. Okay, so we have horizontal set up for the joystick axis. It's the x-axis of the joystick. Vertical is set to the y-axis of the joystick. And again, we can set up from which joystick we want to get this, and it's set up to get motion from all joysticks, which is fine. Okay, and then joystick button 0 is attack, and joystick button 1 is interact. So let's see how this changes our code. Basically, what we can do, instead of having the key code stuff here, we can just address this action by name now, the name that we just set up. So we can have if key down attack, and if key down interact. And those are the names that we set up here. And we can do the same thing for horizontal and vertical. So let's go down to the update direction method here. And basically what we want to do is, instead of listening for WASD, we are getting the stuff from our axis. So we can do, so the X one, we get input get axis, and there's input get axis and input get axis raw. The difference is that get axis is smoothed a little bit, and you can set up the smoothing factor by using the gravity and the dead area and the sensitivity. And basically what this means is the gravity is how fast it goes back, and the sensitivity is how fast it goes to the value that you have set up. And the dead is the dead zone for a joystick. So sometimes a joystick is not calibrated correctly. So in the middle, even if it's supposed to be at 0, it still wiggles around a little bit. So you can set up dead zone. If the value is below this, this means 0. Okay, so let's use the input axis. to have the smoothing and the dead zone in there. And we're going to use horizontal for our X direction and vertical for our Y direction. Vertical. And then we can remove all this code for the key stuff. And then we set the direction and pass this on. I want to change something though. Let me just quickly see. Okay, so I want to change something a little bit because the direction that we're setting now or that we're getting is basically it's analog, so we can get a smooth value from -1 to 1. But the keyboard is only getting digital, is giving digital commands, so it's just full right or full left or none at all, and you don't have anything in between. So I want to make sure that is the same, that the same is happening here as well. So we're checking if the new direction X is not 0, then we want to set it, reset it to. And we're using one of Unity's helper functions right now, and that is the sine function. And the sine function basically returns 1 if the value is positive, or -1 if the value is negative. And we're checking for 0, because I think the sine function returns 1, so a positive value for 0 as well. So if we're at 0, we want to stay at 0. But otherwise, we just want to have either 1 or -1 and nothing in between. And let's do the same thing for the Y axis. And that's it. This is everything to create gamepad controls. Let's press play and see if everything's working. So I'm okay, something. Input key named interact is unknown. Okay. This is. All right. I made a small mistake here. So you can't use the get key down anymore, and with the names you have to rename it to get a button down. In order to use the ones that you set up. And I removed two axes, submit and cancel, which Unity uses for GUI canvas stuff, and it was complaining that they're not set up anymore. So let's set them up and just don't hook them up at all, so they don't mess with the stuff that we want to do. So let's press play again, see. Okay, so no error stuff. And so I can get the sword and stuff with that, but the movement is not working yet. So let's debug this. What's going on here? Let's see what. All right, I think the problem is now we're setting two different. We're setting the direction for the keyboard and the gamepad, and probably the gamepad is setting the direction first and then the keyboard. So it's being set by the gamepad and then reset by the keyboard to 0 again. So in order to prevent that, we are checking if the direction has been set this frame already and to something other than 0. And if it has been set in this exact frame already to something other than 0, then we don't want to set it again. So in order to do that, we need to store a value that checks when it has been set. And so last direction set or last set direction frame count. Make this consistent. Okay, set direction. And we go down here, movement direction. So if direction is not 0, then we said, okay, we set this to not zero. So last direction frame count is time we did this. And then in the up here, we can check if last direction frame count is, or the other way around rather. So if the current frame count is equal to the last direction frame count, so basically if this method has been called already, then we want to return. And not only if this method has been called already, but we're setting this after we checked if the value is not zero. So if this value has been set to something other than zero in this frame, we don't want to set it again. Do you have a YouTube channel? Yes, I do. I upload everything to YouTube. It's just go to letscodegames.com and there's a link to it. Because I don't have a short handle, I don't have youtube.com/letscodegames yet. I need more followers for that. So you can subscribe and hopefully we get that name soon. But the channel is called Let's Code Games, so you can either search for it or go to letscodegames.com and there's a link to it. Okay, let's see if this fixed our issue. Press play, can we move? And now we can move with the gamepad. Perfect. But so one thing that's not really good, I think, is that the method that we use to... Oh, I don't have the sword yet. Let's grab the sword first. The method that... So basically we set the values to zero and the direction values to zero and one always. And this doesn't feel very good. So let's change this a little bit. So in the gamepad control, I want to change this to, first of all, I want to change the get access to get access raw. The difference is that get access raw is not using the smoothing values and the depth values. Basically, you get what you input, the direct input from the gamepad. But I want to implement the dead zone stuff as well. So what we're doing, if the new direction is x is bigger than 0. And let's make a value here. Threshold, I mean, let's say 0.4. So if the x direction is bigger than the threshold, then we just set it to 1. If it's lower than negative threshold, so it's lower than -4, 0.4, then we want to set it to -1, and we do the same thing for the y direction. And this way, we're making sure that it's not going to the left or the right immediately, so basically you have to push the analog stick in the direction quite far in order for it to go in that direction. But that's not working. Oh, yes. And we need to set it to 0, of course, if this is not the case. So if new direction y, so if the absolute value of new direction y is smaller than the threshold, then we want to set it to 0. Otherwise, we can make this a little prettier, so we don't have to check for the threshold again. We checked, so if it's lower than the threshold in either direction, that's why I'm using the abs here, the absolute. Basically, if it's negative, it ignores the sign, basically. So if the direction is smaller than the threshold, then we want to set it to 0. Otherwise, we want to set it to the sign value. So basically, set it to 1, but check if it's +1 or -1, depending on the sign of the input. This is a little nicer. Do this for the x direction as well. And this should feel a little better. So let's move. Okay, so the death zone is good. Yeah, this feels better. I like this. Get the sword. Attack the enemies. Cool. Okay, so, and that's basically it already. Now we have gamepad controls. And they feel pretty good. Cool. So let's check this off our list. Gamepad controls. Done. Perfect. So let's get on to the really, really interesting part that I was looking forward to all week. So, as I said in the beginning, the gameplay that I want for this game should be something close to Binding of Isaac, but still in our Zelda-like world. So, Binding of Isaac is creating dungeons, randomly generated dungeons that have multiple rooms next to each other, and you can basically just pass through the dungeon. And most of the rooms in Binding of Isaac are one screen tall. There are a couple of rooms that are bigger, and I want to code our system in a way that it supports both as well. So just one screen tall rooms and also rooms that are bigger than one screen. But for us, the rooms right now are not really dungeon rooms, but they're outside because we have this outside environment. And we are getting... So Jesse, the artist for this project, is creating dungeon tiles for us. Well, not at the moment. She has something else to do right now. So she still is doing some animations for our character that I need. But then afterwards, she will create dungeon tiles. So we'll have the outside world, and we also have inside dungeon stuff, which is really cool. And then we can have multiple maps. So we start in the outside world, then we can go into a dungeon for level 2, and then 3 is in the outside world again, maybe, and then 4 is the dungeon. So maybe we can have some level progression in randomly generated worlds that goes from outside to a dungeon to outside to a dungeon. I think that might be quite nice. Yeah, so let's figure out how we do some randomly generated levels. So what we need to figure out for this to work is how do we create levels on the fly? And games like Binding of Isaac and Spelunky, for example, they are not completely randomly generated. In fact, they design the rooms and then just mix them up randomly. So and then randomly choose one from all the rooms that are designed and stitch them together. So it's a randomly generated world, but the rooms themselves are designed, which gives us more control over how the rooms will look, because creating fully randomly rooms might not yield in good gameplay. So we can design the rooms ourselves and then just stitch them together randomly, which is a pretty effective method to have a good designed level or well designed level, but still have randomly generated world basically. Okay, so in order to do that, I want to create a new scene for each room. And then in this main scene, we are going to load these rooms and then put them at their specific position. This way we basically have the level editor or the Unity editor for each room. So let's create one basic room that we can use for all rooms for now. So we can start with that. So we just want to have one room, and this one room is just one screen tall. And we'll have exit in all four directions, so we can just use it for whatever, and then we go from there. Okay, I will duplicate this scene and then remove a bunch of stuff from it. Let's create a folder here, rooms. Move this in here, and then call this level 1, so level 1 will be... Oh no, let's call this the overworld. So we can reuse them for multiple levels if we want to. So put this in the overworld rooms folder, and let's go over here. So in this, so now we are in the game. Okay, so let's call this room basic. Let's call this overworld basic or empty or whatever. Okay, so now we are in the overworld empty room, and let's remove a bunch of stuff. First of all, we don't need the character in here, because it will be in the main scene, and this scene will be loaded into that. But I want to store the camera, so I have this border, so I know how big the room is. So, store the camera, remove the character, remove the enemies here. Can move the rupee, remove everything that's in the level, basically. So we can remove the canvas. Don't need the event system. Let's remove the short shrine and the particles and the sign. And with those we can design a level, basically. And there's one more bat that we don't need. Okay, first of all, let's create a script or let's create a game object that is the parent to all these level objects. Because by doing this, we can later on load the level into our main level. And because everything will be parented to one game object, we can just move that game object to whatever position the room has to be. And so the whole room will be moved. So let's start with that. We call this room parent, and this will be at 000. And then we can create a script for this as well. So the room parent script. Let's make a new folder, rooms. And we call a room parent script. And this script basically can help us with a bunch of design stuff. And so we can define later on, we can use the script to define how big the room is, and we can use it as well to use the start function from this parent to know when the room has been loaded, so we can set it to the proper position and stuff like that. Did you make the art yourself? No, a friend of mine did the art, Jessica Carger, and she basically creates new stuff every week for us. So if I would do the art, it would be stick figures and stuff, and it would not be as interesting to look at. So, okay, the room... The room parent... So let's put the camera at 000 as well. Okay, first of all, what I want to do is, when I click on the main camera, you see the border here, and this is really helpful to design the levels to know where the border is. So basically I want to have the border at all times without having to select the camera, right? Because I actually don't want to have the camera in this scene here. So we can use something called gizmos for that. Let's go to our room parent object here. Now, first of all, how big is the camera? So it's size 6 and then 16 by 9 is our default size. Okay. So let's go to the room parent. And a gizmo is basically some debug stuff that you can draw into the scene view that is only visible in the Unity editor and not in the game view. Well, you can make it visible in the game view when you're in the Unity editor, but it won't be visible when you play the game later. So you can draw a bunch of debug data with this. And to do this, you implement a method called onDrawGizmos. And then you can do a gizmos.and draw wire cube, for example. And the center is, let's say, our position, and then the size of the cube is 5 and it doesn't have a Z height. And then we can also set the color by setting gizmos.color, and let's make it red for now. And when it compiles, you will see that there's this red wire cube. And since this is 2D, a wire cube basically is just a rectangle, right? And well, we made it flat, so, but you can draw 3D objects as well. So I want to make this as big as the camera. And since this is an orthographic camera, we have our orthographic size to 6. And what this is basically the size from the center to the top or the bottom. So in order to match the height, I think we have to set the height to 12, because it's from the center to the top 6, and from the center to the bottom is 6. Together it should be 12. So let's see if I remembered that correctly. Let's compile this. Perfect. This is the correct height. And then to get the correct size for the width, it's also 12, but then it's multiplied by 16 divided by 9, because we have a 16 by 9 screen here. So it's multiplied by the aspect ratio of the camera. So the width is 12 multiplied by 16 divided by 9. And it compiles, and there you see it's what's going on. It's almost right, but not quite. Well, why is this almost right? All right, so let's not use 16 by 9. Let's use, maybe it's just a rounding error. Let's use the camera, main camera aspect ratio. Then let's see. And this fixes it. All right. Can you make it a float? Yeah, that might have been the issue. I divided 16 by 9, and because they weren't float, it was rounded down. But I think this is actually much better to use the camera aspect value ratio. And the same thing, we can also use the camera main orthographic size. And this way, if we change the camera value later, this will change as well. But the problem is, once I delete this camera, this is not valid anymore, because we won't be able to access the camera main. So let's make those values ourselves. So camera size is 12. And then camera aspect ratio is 16. And the problem is I divided 16 by 9 like this. And these are both integers, so it's rounded down to an integer. But let's just make those two floats. And then we can have this again. So camera size. Also, this code is way better than the code we had before, because we had a bunch of numbers in here, and in code speak, these are called magic numbers. If you just put a number into a function and you don't know where the number is coming from, you basically need to comment it why you're using that number. But you can also just store them in the variable and name the variable what this number is. So this way, I mean, you're still using numbers here, but since the 12 is stored in the camera size variable, another coder knows, okay, camera size is 12 and the aspect ratio is 16 by 9. So this way you're giving the number a name and description, basically. Okay. So now we have our red rectangle here. Our red rectangle that tells us how big the scene is. And then we can, and this is our room parent here. So let's put all the stuff that we have here. Let's put all of that into our room parent environment as well. And then we can delete the main camera. But we don't see it in the game view anymore. This might be not as bad, so we know that we are in what scene we are. Because pressing play in that scene should do nothing at all, because the scene should be loaded into the main scene. Okay. So now we need to figure out how we can design the scene so multiple of those scenes can be put next to each other, and then we can move between them. I think the easiest method would be, so we have to figure out what our tree line is here. So let's deactivate all this stuff for now that we don't need, and just have the big trees here so we can work with them. We don't need the one in the center here. We basically just want to make the surrounding of the level. So let's put this here and this here. Then this will be over here. We have to figure out is figure out a position so it's kind of like a puzzle so they can fit next to each other, so the levels can fit next to each other. This doesn't work quite right. So we can put this over here as well. What's going on with the colliders of the trees? What is going on? They're just regular colliders. And we use the polygon collider, so Unity creates the polygons here, and so basically it's Unity. The lines in between are not necessary because the collider basically is just this, so the surrounding here. But yeah, Unity basically shows you the polygons in here, but those are not necessary really. So let's figure out how can we do our tree line. Okay, let's make sure we can delete all of those. Okay, first of all, we want to be able to have an entrance in the center. So for the left and right one, this works because we can just delete those, but for the top and bottom one, this doesn't work. So let's just have this one tree here, put this in the center. Zero is the center, and then create our trees from here. And then we do the same for the bottom row. I mean, we could do it like this, and then just, if we have multiple room parents here, we can put them together like this, but then they would overlap here as well. We could put them together like this, maybe? That might work. And then, since we're deleting the middle ones, we can get past there. This is our main one, yes, okay. If we do that, we could create another one here and another one here. That works for left and right. Because if we create a new room and we put it here, and then this work, this looks pretty nice actually. Okay, so let's figure out the same for top and bottom. I mean, we could put it like this, but it doesn't look as nice because the trees are not intersecting here. So for the bottom, we could create another row of trees and offset them. But then we would have to have a huge entrance to move between, and I don't like that. This is not an easy problem to figure out. So let's not have a three line here. If we have them like this, and then we could offset the top ones, maybe. Wait, no, this is... Oh shit. No, let's put the other one to the top so we can... So we can design our main room, and then the other one is just to help us figure this out. So we can put the trees here, but then they're the same as... How would we do that? Could do it like this. Then we just delete the center tree. That works. I have the center ones deleted here. And then can we make them overlap? We could do it like this. I think this is the best solution. But then the screens are overlapping, so the screen is not... Let's make the screen size not like this, but we're basically defining the width and the height of the room. So the height, and then we can use the width here. Let's make not... This not depend on the camera. So the height is 12, and then the width can be 12 and 16, 18, 20. All right. So we can have it like this. And then the rooms are basically would be created like this. I think this works. Okay, let's try this. So do we need those? No, we don't need those trees anymore, basically. Okay, so this is our basic empty room, right? And then we can just walk between all the multiple different rooms. Okay, let's go back to our main scene. And, well, let's store this level. So this was our test level. And then in the game, we are basically removing the environment, and we're removing the bat and the grass and the flowers and these bats and the sign, rupee, chest, sword shrine, and all of that. Basically, we just have an empty scene that we load rooms into. Okay, so let's create a new object called room manager. And we create a script room manager, and it will load, take care of loading the rooms. Okay. So, in the start method, so let's start very simple. Load room int x and end y. So we have an x and y position always. And at the start, we're loading the room 0, 0, and then the ones next to it as well. So we're loading 5. Now let's just load one room for now to keep it simple. So there's this method in Unity called application load level additive. So you can load level normally, and then you would just switch the scene. You can also load a level additive, which basically means the scene stays the same and the level you're loading just gets added to the same theme. And then you have the same too with async. And async means that loading the level will be taken care of in the background and the game can continue. And once the async level loading is finished, you can do something with the level. So we're going to use the async stuff, and in order to wait for the level to being loaded and stuff like that, this can all be in a coroutine. So we have a load room routine x and y again, and then we're loading the room, and we need a name. Of course, we need a name of the room. And then we start the coroutine here, load room routine, and then we pass these on. And then here, for now, we just name it empty, and then but we have it in the overworld. It's called overworld empty, so we can have. Let's just say that our current string, current world name is overworld. And then we're loading the additive async using the current world name first, and we're combining that with the name that we got in. So this is overworld and this is empty. And then later, we just need to make sure that the rooms are named properly, but later we could have a dungeon empty or whatever. We can have different worlds basically, and then, so for example, we could have a dungeon empty room, then so we change this to dungeon, and then we're loading the room dungeon, loading the room empty, and right here we're combining this to dungeon empty in that case. And this way we can reuse the same loading script for all the different levels later on. How are you achieving the Y sorting? I assume you mean the Y sorting of the trees. Well, we used a trick earlier. So, wait, let me fix this first, uncomment this, so I can show you in our test level that we have. Go to where's our test? So I'm going to assume you need the Y sorting of the trees, and we use a trick for the trees so that we can walk behind them and we can walk in front of them as well. See, and so when we approach them from below, we are in front of them, and if we approach them from the top, we are behind them. And the simple trick that we use is the one tree is basically two objects. So we have a top object here, and that is in front of everything, and then we have a below object. And an added benefit is that when we add the trees, place the trees in our level like this, they're sorted correctly automatically because the top part is always above the bottom part. All right, let's go back to our empty scene here. And we are loading our room. So load level like this, and then we get a async operation. We're getting a variable back, async operation, and then we can basically do while load level is done. While this is not loaded, then we want to wait. And we could, I mean, we don't really need that. I mean, what we could do here is we could write a debug value or stuff like that, that loading level, let's put this in the, put this in a separate variable here. And so we can use this in here as well. And then we can use the load level progress, which basically is a value from 0 to 1, how far the level is loaded. Multiply this by 100. And round this, multiply 100 and add a percent sign. So we basically have a debug output, how far the level is loaded. So we're loading, but it would be very quickly, so we won't really notice, I'm sure. So load room empty. Let's press play and see if this worked. Oh, I think we forgot to add the room manager to the object. Room manager, press play. Still nothing? Oh, okay, so there's the error, overworld empty, couldn't be loaded because it's not added to our build settings. So make sure that our scenes are added, so game is added, and then we want to add the overworld empty room as well. Play, and there it is loaded. Our character is not in the center. Let's put him in the center as well, at 0, 0, 0. So they're all set at the same position. And there, our scene is loaded on top of our already existing scene. So this is a very cool trick. And then we need to figure out how to move this new level, basically. And this is why I basically have this room parent here, because then we can move the whole parent to move the room. So let's figure out how to do that. I mean, what we could do is, so we are loading room at a specific position, but we cannot pass on data to that room or to that scene in any way. So we need to make sure that when the level is loaded, we are moving the level to its proper position, the room. So what we can do is, since we have this room parent object, we can just call the room manager from our room parent start function, because the start function is of course called as soon as the object is created. And in this case, this means our room was it was done loading. So let's make sure that we can access our room manager, and I'm going to use a singleton variable here again. And we're setting this up in the awake method. And then we can have a method called register room. Does it? Okay, let's one step at a time. And then from the room parent, we're going to call the room manager instance register room, and then we want to register ourselves. And then we still don't have the data from here in here. Is there anything we can allow scene activation? No. Priority in progress. Okay, so it's we are not able to communicate between from this one where we know the position to the register room. So what we can do is we can store the position in our room manager and then set it here. But this creates a problem because if you load multiple rooms at the same time, then you can only store one position for the rooms. So, in order to fix that, we can create a queue. So we're making sure that only one room is being loaded at the same time. So when calling load room, we're not calling load room routine immediately, but we're storing this this data, basically this room data, in a list, and then we're just going through that list one after another. How about map level 9 vector 2? The problem with that is that you cannot have the same room twice. And so if a room has the same name, then yeah, basically it will still conflict. So let's implement a loading queue here. For that we are going to need a couple of variables. Current board name, current load room x, and current load room y, and string current load room name. I mean, yeah, let's create a class for that. Room data public and x, public and y, and public string name. And then we have current load room data, and we also want to have a using system collection generic. There is an object called the queue, which basically does what we want already. So we creating a queue with room data. Load room queue. And then basically what we do in this method here is we are creating the room data for this new room data. Set up the variables x to x and new room data y to y. And then we're adding this to our queue. It's not add, what is it? Push. Right? Was it push? No. And queue. Okay. And queue. New room data. Then we have stuff in our queue. And basically what we're doing is is it being set to 0 again? So, okay, so, and then in the update method, update room queue. You basically, first of all, we have, let's put a flag here, is loading room, false. So if we are already loading a room, then we don't want to do any, anything with the queue. If we are not loading, and if our queue, no, what do they call it? The load queue. If we have something in our queue, well, let's return this. So if the queue is empty, we want to return. Otherwise, we are going to get the first element from our queue. We don't want to use. So basically, we're using dequeue, which removes the first element of the queue and returns the data to us. And then we are responsible of handling that data. So we're dequeuing the first room in the queue, and then we're calling start coroutine load room routine, pass on the data here. And we set is loading room to true. So now we know that we are loading a room. In the routine here, we have our data. So let's make sure that the data is being set here. We're loading the stuff and everything is fine with that. But once the scene has finished loading, the room parent is going to call register room this. And so this method is being called once the level is done. And then we can basically, so we have the room parent. We need to do one more. So the room queue, we need to store that as well. So the current load, I have it already set up here. So the current load room data is this. Current load room data. And then we can check our current load room data and set the room parent transform position to our X and Y positions. Right? And then we set to is loading to false again, because our room has been loaded. So let's see if this is working. Let's have 5 different rooms. Let's put a new debug variable here, debug log loading new room name at x y. Press play. I mean, they should be loading pretty quickly, so let's see. Okay. So you saw they are loading pretty quickly, but and they are being moved. So we have position 0, negative 1, and stuff like that. But the room position and the world position is different. So we need to multiply that by the width and height of our rooms, which was 20 and 12. So in the register stuff, we multiply x by 20, and these are magic numbers again. So for Oh no, we have the room parent. So we can just have the room parented width and room parent.height. Let's press play again. And there you go. Zoom out again. And you can see that they're loaded one after another. It's pretty quick, so I'm not sure if it reads on stream, but you can see that they're appearing one after the other. And then we can move between our rooms here. Cool. So, hello, I missed the start of the level generation. Are you recording the video? Yes, I am, actually, and I am uploading all these videos to YouTube as well. So you can find the channel. If you go to letscodegames.com, then you can find the link to it, to the YouTube channel there. Or just search for Let's Code Games on YouTube. Okay, so now what I want to do is, first of all, I'm going to go to the third to-do option for today and have the camera stuff going, because the camera should be fixed here, and then when we pass onto the room up here, it should move pretty quickly, and then we know if when we enter a new room, because as soon as I enter this room, I want the next rooms surrounding this. Oh yeah, thanks for proposing the channel. it's not a cool channel URL yet. Or maybe I just have letscodegames.com/YouTube or something, so it links to the channel. So yeah, so let's change the camera so it's not parented to our character anymore, but it stays in the room basically, and it just stays in the center of the room, and then if we enter a new room, it moves to the new room pretty quickly, which is a simple start. First of all, we're removing the main camera from our character, so it's not parented to it anymore. So basically, we can press play and see how the camera would work in one room. Basically, you can walk around here, and then if we go out of this room to the top, the camera moves to the new room here. So let's create a new script. Maybe have a folder general. Call it game camera. I'm thinking about where I want to store the value in which room the character set. It's probably the character itself who knows in which room the character is. Now let's have it in the room manager, actually, in which position. Is that a good... Well, for now we're storing that in the camera, and then we'll figure that out later. So, first of all, I again want to have a static instance of this camera, and we're setting this in awake. And then for now, I'm using the room position X and Y stuff, which is the same coordinates that we use in the room manager here. So basically in room space. Later on, I want to change it because I want to add rooms that are bigger than one screen later. But for now, we only have rooms that are as big as one screen, so this is a valid option to have. Okay, so I have the room position. Well, actually, let's make it differently. Let's make it Let's have a room parent and then know in which room we are. And then in the room parent, we're storing the x and y values that we set in the room manager once the room is registered. So we're not only setting the position of the room, we're also setting the x and y values. So the room itself knows where it is. This 2y and this 2y. And this way we can store our room parent in our camera and then move it to there. So let's have update position in here. If the current room is null, then we don't want to do anything. Otherwise, we're going to check our target position, which is, let's have it in our room parent. Let's create a method called getRoomCenter. And this is basically the x times width and y times height. Again, this will change later, but for now this works. And then we don't want to set the camera to that position because then the camera would teleport, but we want to move it pretty quickly over there. So we're going to use transform position. We're going to use move towards. This is the helper method for Unity. And then so it needs the current position, which is the transform position. It needs the target position, which we have in here. And then it needs a value how fast it should move. And I'm always using time delta time here, so it doesn't matter how fast your game is rendering, it's always the same on each computer. But let's make it pretty fast. So, but we can just make it a float here. It's not zoom speed, so it's float movement speed on room change. And we put them in here. Awake. All right. So in the camera, let's add our game camera to our camera object here. This should be, let's put it to 30. And then in our room manager, we have to set up in which room we are. So once the first room is loaded, how do we know it's the first room? Let's have a list of all the rooms that we already loaded. So list, room parent, loaded rooms. This way we can check, we can use this list later as well to check if a room was already loaded at a specific position, so we don't load a room twice. So once we register the room, we add this room to the list. And if our loaded rooms list is empty, before we adding that, then this is the first room that we loaded. So we're going to access the game camera, instance, current room, and set the room that we just loaded to our current room here. And we can fake the behavior for now in the editor. So stuff is loaded. The camera is moving, but it needs to stay at its Z position. So that position is negative 30. Update position. And then we're putting to Z position to what the Z position already is. Otherwise the camera would move to position 0 and then all the sprites are behind the camera. Press play again. Okay, so the camera, the scene are loaded, and in our camera we can see the current room is set to our room parent. Let's change the name of the room parent to include the position so we know it pretty quickly. So the room parent dot name, we call this world name, put a dash in between, and then add the room parent name, put it, a dash is not as good, and then we put the x and the y value here. And this way, our rooms have a better name. See, so it's overworld room parent. Why is the room parent dot name? Oh, I don't want to have the room parent dot name. I want to use the load data dot name. So we're using the name of the scene. So overworld empty, and then we have 000, and then basically we have the coordinates here, so we can see it better. So in the camera, we can see we are at overworld empty 000 right now. And if we move up, I mean, right now nothing is happening, of course, because we haven't coded that part yet. But we can fake it by just using main camera, and then this is the room we are in right now, so let's drag it over here. And then it's going there. And it's not even quick enough. So let's put this to 50. Go back to the center room. That's all right. Let's put 60 in here. I think this is good. And then it's moving pretty quickly to the next scene if we change. So now we need to figure out when the character is leaving the room. And we can do that by going back to our empty room. Going back to our room, and in our room parent, we are adding a collider here. Box collider 2D. And it has the same size as our room, and it's a trigger. So this way we can basically have on trigger enter and use that to change the room. But what we can do is, because now if we have it at the same size as the room, there might maybe some flickering back and forth, or fighting back and forth basically. So let's make it a little bit smaller. And this way, if we enter the room, and then we need to enter the room a little bit more to collide with the trigger, and then we know, okay, we are at this room now. Hope that makes sense. So let's go to the room parent, and then we can listen for on trigger enter 2D collider, and if collider tag is the player, then basically we know that the player entered ourselves, entered the room that we are in right now, and then we can set let's pass this on to the room manager. So on player enter room, I'm going to have this at a center location. The room itself should just notify the room manager that the player is entering a room. So on player enter room, this, and then the room manager can set the game camera instance current room to the room parent. I just want to have it at the important stuff happening at one spot. If every room would manage the camera stuff, it could create conflicts later on. This and by having this in a room manager, we can later on also have some checks if the room was just recently changed and stuff like that. So So let's see here. Having rooms keep track of the entities inside seems like a good design. Thank you. If it simplifies all kinds of stuff, when you only want the simulation to run inside the actual room. Yeah, exactly. I mean, you always have to think about where you want your code to be running. It's the same with the room manager, with what I did right now here in passing this on to the room manager. By thinking about where you want to run your code, it's actually pretty important because later on, if you're just running code all over the place, it would be much harder to debug later if you have an error and you don't quite know which part of your code is producing the error. So yeah, you should always think about where the actual important stuff is, which part of your code is accessing what data and stuff like that.
How do you link Unity's defines into Visual Studios? Like, how do you get the pull down for transform in Visual Studio? I reinstalled Mono just cause I couldn't access Unity thing.
This should happen automatically, actually. Because you can see here in the assembly, Visual Studio has a link set up to all of that. I actually don't remember if I needed to set up anything. Like, because you're using the project files that Unity generates, all this stuff is already set up for you. And I could be wrong, but I think it should just work, actually. Okay, so we have on player enter room, and then we setting the current room to the room that we just entered. So let's see if that works. I'm curious. This is a trigger. Okay, it should. Let's go back to our main room, main scene here, press play. Oh, there's a script error here. The onTriggerEnter has to be of type, the parameter has to be a collider2d. Thanks, Unity. Press play. Let's see if we can move another room. Perfect! Look at that! So one thing... that's pretty cool. And now, because we know that we entered a new room, I mean, yeah, we can still pass because there's no room here, but since the room manager knows that we entered a new room, we can check if the room already has its neighbors loaded, and if the neighbors don't exist yet, we can start loading those neighbors immediately. So let's do that. Let's create a method called does room exist? X and Y. And basically, we're checking our loaded rooms list. I mean, we need to check the loaded rooms list and the queue, actually, but for now we're just checking the loaded rooms list. So, loaded rooms, find the room where the X position is equal to X and the Y position is equal to Y. So this is a really cool syntax. I'm not sure if everybody knows what this is. This is called a lambda expression. And what you can do in the generic list here that we and many of the generic stuff have these methods. So basically we have a find method that requires it requires a system predicate, but and what this is we are defining a variable, so find an item, we giving it a name. Then you have the equal, and so basically this arrow here, and then you're defining what conditions this item has to meet in order to be found by this. So basically, find an item that has, and then the item position, this is the same name as we defined up here. So find an item that has the X position equal to X and the Y position equal to Y. And we can access these variables because the loaded room list is a list of room parents. So it knows here that the item is of type room parent. And the room parent, of course, has these X and Y values set. So find an item that has the X position at X and the Y position at Y. And then we can basically just return. So if this does room exist, if this is, if this query does not return null, so if it returns any object at all, then a room exists. And if it returns null, then we don't have a room. So this is what we're doing here. So on player enter room. Let's use this in our load room data. If does room exist X and Y, then we don't want to load a room. Because this way we can basically on enter room, we can say load room, room parent X plus one and room parent Y. Basically when we enter a room, oh, let's call it, we want to load an empty room, always. So when we enter a new room, we want to load the neighboring rooms. And the load room method checks if a room already exists and then doesn't load it if it's already there. Okay. Press play, and now you should see when we enter a new room, then it automatically loads the neighboring rooms. There you go. It's pretty cool, right? And then we can go wherever we want, and it loads empty rooms as long as we go into new rooms. So right now we have an endless empty map, which is cool, but pretty boring actually. Okay, so let's make sure that this is a little bit more interesting. First of all, we need our sort. So let's have let's copy this sort shrine from our test level, and we create an overworld start room. And the start room basically has the shrine. You can put it like this. This is difficult. The shrine is so big. Let's just put him here. Let's see where the center position is really quick, if this works. I need to put this one down. Okay, so this is our start room. So we have overworld empty and overworld start. So what we want to do is we want to load the start room at 000. Go back to our game. Oh, we need to remember to add new scenes to our list here. I need to figure something out so that happens automatically or something. So there you go. So our start room was created here, and then we have empty rooms around that. So we can move up to our sword, grab the sword, and then we can start our adventure. Cool, right? And then if we go all the way around, we can access this from the side, but yeah, we couldn't get to the sword. We can only leave this, access the sword from the bottom. And this is how we would do the whole game, basically. Now that we have this room generation and we can load different kinds of rooms, we just create a bunch of them. And then every time we enter a new room, we don't load the empty room, but we load a random one. So, let's demonstrate that. Let's duplicate the empty room and call this regular 00. I'm just using that name, so I think we can have every world could have multiple regular rooms, and then you just choose one at random from the regular room, so regular 00 or regular 01, whatever. And then we can have other special rooms as well. So let's open the regular room, and then from the test scene, from the test level, we're going to add a bat and a sign and a tree maybe, and maybe some bushes. Let's copy some of the stuff here and add this to our regular room. So the bat is here, we have a sign, we have an additional tree that we can maybe put here. We have some bushes and a stone. So just some very basic level design. So this is our regular zero room, and then we duplicate this and have our regular room one, and this room maybe has some more bats and doesn't have this, and the bushes are over here. And maybe some more of those, and it doesn't have a sign. You get the idea. I'm not going to do the level design on stream here. I'm going to do that offline. But yeah, basically we just create a bunch of different rooms. And then let's see. I mean, if we don't have this, it should still load the rooms around it, right? Because we are entering the trigger. Let's see if the trigger is being if the trigger is being used like this, is the trigger is being activated. So let's go back into the game, press play. Okay, so the trigger is being activated, this is good. Go to our build settings, add the rooms that we just created. Regular 0 and regular 1. And now what we can do is we are not loading empty here, but we just get random regular room name. So let's have an array of possible rooms. And it could be empty, it could be regular 00, or it could be regular 01. And then we basically just return possible rooms with a random index from 0 to possible rooms.length. Okay. So what are we doing here? We created an array with three entries, so empty, regular 0, and regular 1, and then we return one of those empties, but we're choosing the index at random. And the random number should be between 0, which is the first index, and the maximum length of the room. So in this case, possible rooms has a length of 3, so the random range should be between 0 and 3. And here's a small quirk of Unity's random functions. So you have two different random functions. It's overloaded for floats and it's overloaded for integers. And if you use the float one, let's say you have 0 float to 3 float, 3 is a possible value in this one. But if you're using the integer one, 3 is not. So basically you want you're getting a value from 0, 1, or 2 in this case here. And this is what we want, because 0 would be this, 1 is this, and 2 is this. If we would get a 3, then it would be longer than our array, and it wouldn't exist. Okay, so, and then except instead of loading the empty rooms, we're just getting a regular room name every time. So now, when new rooms get loaded, they get picked at random from our list. See here? So we have the first room, we have an empty room here, there's a second room up here. And this is the basis for our random level design. So we have enemy here, we can read the sign. We cannot read the sign. Why can't we read the sign? Oh, I just copied the visuals for the sign. Oh, that's not good. And I did the same for the stone as well. Yeah, I screwed it up a little bit with the colliders and stuff. Oh, this bat is... Okay, let's fix the collider stuff that I messed up here. Let's go to regular, access the stone. The stone visuals should always be at 000. So I duplicated the visuals object and not the stone object itself. And that's because this is not a prefab. And if it's not a prefab, it's selecting the object that you click on itself. If this would be a prefab, then the topmost object would be selected. And I think I did the same for the she sign and the bushes, because they're prefabs. If I click on them, the main bush is being selected, which is good. This bat is not very nice. Okay, let's go back to the test level and copy the actual sign. Put that in here. Let's see if I messed this up here as well. Yes, I did. Okay. So, press play, and then we get our random level generation. Here, whoops. So okay, the bats are pushing me back in the scene transition, so I need to figure out how to fix that, but still. Okay, move over here. Basically, we can go on our randomly generated adventure. Then the sign, hey, how are you doing? It's working. And yeah, basically, no matter where I go, the world just gets generated. Okay, I need to figure something out for the bats. They shouldn't know where I am across level boundaries, and they should also not push me back or something. Yeah. We'll figure something out for that in a second. But we did our camera. We also did some random level generation. But we're still working, so the camera works as just like I want, and I'll leave it at that for now. I mean, later we want to have bigger rooms as well, and the camera moves with us, unless you get to the room border. But for now, this is pretty good. But for the random level generation, first of all, we want to have an ending to the level as well. So let's create the ending, for example, at the 15th room that gets loaded or something like that. So we need to find that ending, and then also we want to figure out how we can create the rooms in such a way so that they don't always have to have entrances to all four directions. So that might be something that's cool as well. So to do that, there's a really simple thing that we can do. That's pretty cool. Let's create the trees here that are blocking the doorway, basically, and then we create scripts, room door blocking object. So there can be two types of room doors, basically. If you're in a dungeon, we need to add a door to go somewhere. And if we're here, we need to remove a tree, or remove an object to be able to go somewhere. In this case, the tree. So we have a room door blocking object, which basically we can set up a random probability if it gets destroyed or not. Destroy probability, and then in our start method we check float random value, we get a random value, random range between 0 and 1 as a float value. Don't I have a completion here? And then if our random value is lower than the destroy probability, then we want to destroy this game object. So we can add this blocking object to this room, and let's call this big tree door left, right, top, bottom, right, top, and bottom. Top one goes here, the bottom one goes here, and then the probability to destroy this, let's make this, it should be high, because you need to remember, since we're creating the level inside each other, this tree on the left of this level, so if two rooms are next to each other like this, basically both door trees have to be destroyed, the left one from this room and the right tree from this room. So let's make the probability that they get destroyed quite high. And because the probability is 0.8 and you have to do this two times because both trees has to be destroyed, we basically have a probability of 0.64 that there is a door, and then the other times the tree will be blocking. I mean, this is pretty high. Let's make this 7. So yeah, so this way, by using 0.7, we have about half our objects, our pathways are doors, and the other half are blocked. And let's add these trees to all. Why didn't it copy those? So copy the trees and add them here. And for now we're just making this really just random. And later I want to have artificial intelligence, some algorithm that figures out a cool room level design and then puts the doors and stuff like that. But for now we're just keeping it completely random. Oh no, I can't press play here. Oh, yeah, and if we press play in our room manager instance, if the log warning play in a room and not in the main scene. So if the room manager doesn't exist, we are in the wrong scene. Let's go back to game. Press play and see what this random doors are doing for us. See here, so we cannot go. Oh, I don't have that. Should pick up the sword. Yeah, the bat is really just cheating. But you can see here, there is this entrance is closed, but there's an entrance to the bottom. There's a bat again. The bat is at. I need to change it so that the bat is. Let's make them close to here, so they won't attack immediately when you get here. So back to the scene. Press play. And we can see in our scene view already what is gets destroyed, created. Oh, so this is a problem. Okay. So now we cannot go down here because there's a tree. And we're basically stuck in the very first scene. That's problematic. Yeah, but I mean, yeah, because we're doing this completely random, it could happen that we have dead ends in here, and then that we cannot go any further, basically. I forgot to pick up the sword again. It's dangerous to go alone. Take the sword. But yeah, it's pretty cool, right? So now we're creating a level that, so we can't go everywhere. So there's a tree blocking down here, and there's the tree blocking at the top, so we can only go right and left, and stuff like that. So yeah, let's create the end of the game as well, because we have some cool art for that. There's the question, how do you make a drop-down list in Unity Inspector with the following options, vector 3 up, down, left, right? What you can do is you create an enum for that. So let's use this. So public enum direction, and then you call it up, down, left, right, and then you can have a value for that. Let's go to a room. And then you have your direction here, up, down, left, right. And then if you want to, you basically need another method that converts this enum to a vector for you. So you basically have a switch statement. If the value is up, then return vector 3 up and stuff like that. And I mean, we're going to use this later as well to when we create create a dungeon layout artificially. So we can set up stuff like, for example, in the start room, we can make sure that the direction down is always accessible and stuff like that. What would the switch statement look like? Let me show you quickly. So vector 3 get vector from direction. It gets a direction here. And then you basically just switch direction case up, return vector 3 up, case down, and so on. And left, right as well. So right now this is an error because the switch statement could have, so if the direction is left, then the switch statement does not return anything. And so basically not all code paths return a value. That this is what that means. So you could either have a vector 0 down here, this way if the switch statement isn't complete, or you can have a default value in your switch statement that gets used when nothing else is being passed. Or in our case, since this is or if you just basically give an option for all the possibilities. Oh no, it cannot detect that. All right, so you need either have a default label in here or have a return below that as well. But yeah, this is how this would look. Okay, so let's, as the final act for today, let's create an end level, a last room basically. So overworld end. And for this, I have, let me grab this. I have a new object from Jesse for this. Zelda 3, Jesse, environment, dungeon entrance. I haven't exported it from Photoshop yet, so let's do that quickly. This is basically the... Oh, this is too big. So we have a nice dungeon entrance here. Let's reduce that in size so it's the same size as all the other objects, because Jesse is creating these objects 4 times as big as we need them for our game.
but it's always good to have high resolution source files. And then save this in our project. Tutorial sprites environment dungeon entrance.png.
Okay, let's put this here. Environment dungeon entrance. This is 64 as always. So I have a dungeon entrance here, and we are going to create a polygon collider, so we can only access this from the bottom. This here, here. Doesn't need to be. I think this should be fine. We should be small enough to fit in there. So we have our dungeon entrance. And then let's say in our room manager, first of all, we need to add this to our list of scene objects, so overworld end. And then in our room manager, how do we do that? We need to make sure that this actually gets loaded. We need to make sure that this gets loaded. If it exists, -1, -1, remove those. Then have +1 here. And then have -1. Well, no, I don't like this. We could just. Basically, what we can do is. If loaded rooms count plus our queue, do we have a count for that? Yes, we have a count as well. Let's say 15, then change the name to end. This is hacky as well right now. Again, later on, we create a script that plans the level and positions them. But for now, the 15th room that we are loading should be the end room. Go to the game. Come on, I need an entrance. All right, OK. Let's see if we can find our exit. Something isn't working. Or was it created and I missed it somewhere? Oh, it was. But why was it? What? Something is wrong. If loaded rooms count is equal to 15, set the name to end. No, let's do it. Let's make it differently. Let's put it. We just put it somewhere. Negative. So one to the right and two below should be the end room. I mean, later on we need to make sure that the end room is actually in our I think I haven't parented. Yeah, I haven't parented the dungeon entrance properly. That's the issue. All right. Okay, so let's go back to our game. Let's play here. So you can see here, our start room is created. Let's make sure that we have an entrance to the bottom. So our start room is created, the random rooms get created around that, and then at our position -2, 1 we have our exit. And we can only access this from the right, so let's see if we can get to the exit. I mean, now we have this map here, which is cheating, but still. Go to the right here. Have to go down. Can go to the right again. Can go up. Go to the right. I'm getting really close. Oh no, and then the last room messed it up for us. And then. So the exit is completely enclosed now. Yeah, and that happens if you do this completely at random. I think next week we should create some sort of level designer script so that stuff like this does not happen. But yeah, I mean, this is a good start for our random level generation. I think for next week I'm also going to create a couple of these rooms just so we have more variety. And yeah, and then next week we're going to figure out how we can create a room designer so a path is created and stuff like that, and everything actually makes sense and we don't have issues like this where we cannot reach the exit. But it's 8 o'clock now, and as always we're streaming for 2 hours. So if you like this, please make sure that you follow me on Twitch, so next time I go live you get a message and you can follow along. Also on letscodegames.com you can find a link to the YouTube channel, and I can post the link for you as well in the chat. So yeah, please subscribe to the YouTube channel as well and you get all the videos, and actually I'm doing more videos on there as well. So I put all the live streams on here, but I also have some tips videos like here. I posted a tips video about Unity in general, and then I also create some 3 to 4 minute videos explaining a couple of the stuff that we do in the live stream, so you don't have to watch the full 2 hour live stream. So yeah, if you want to learn more about that, subscribe to Let's Code Games, follow me on Twitch if you want to learn when the next live stream is going live. And usually I'm streaming on Saturday, but next Saturday I'm gone. I'm at an event in Cologne and showing my game that I'm working on in my full time. So yeah, if you're in Cologne and going to RPC, come by and say hi. Otherwise, we are going to see each other next on, let's say, May 24th again. That's the 23rd, May 23. Yeah, May 23rd is the next Saturday that we're going to stream this tutorial series. So I hope to see you then, and hope you got something from the stream and you learned something, and yeah, make sure you code more games. Bye everyone.